Hey friends and family, so I'm on the USS Iowa, which is a sister ship of the New Jersey. There's four great super dreadnoughts, the most powerful gunships ever built in the world. The Missouri, Wisconsin, Iowa, New Jersey. My dad served on the New Jersey in the Vietnam War. He was in charge of gun turret number two. The one you see behind me that's pointed up, turret number one's in front of it. And I just took a bunch of really spectacular video and photo footage and lots of really cool historical data for you history nerds out there. I think you're really gonna enjoy it. I'm gonna put it all together and make a really cool video montage for you. So if you got some other friends who'd like to see something like that, share this video. And they do excellent self-guided tours here, or if you wanna snag somebody who, you know, is while working here, they're happy to show you around and just enthusiastically show you some really cool stuff about this amazing ship, okay? And my website is tombirkenmeyer.com, just like it's spelled on social media, tombirkenmeyer.com. And I have lots of content about, well, other things, but if you want to see more of my stuff, it's there. So share this video and enjoy the rest of this video, okay? Here we go, stepping aboard the USS Iowa. Super dreadnought battleship. Oh, this is so cool.
Battleship Iowa.
Thank you very much. My dad served on the New Jersey in Vietnam.
Wow. That, she was the only Iowa class sister ship that was in.
So one day we had an accident. They had an accident.
After the gun turret accident of 1989, President George H.W. Bush held a memorial service at Norfolk Naval Base for the sailors who died in the explosion, thus marking the third presidential visit of Iowa's career, more than any other U.S. battleship. In October of 1990, Iowa was decommissioned for the last time.
This is a number two engine room decommissioning for 26 October 1990. And they quote, "The best clear to rest, liberties and prize, lives will
return." Faced with government costs,
I can't imagine getting hit with one of those shells. There'd be nothing left of you. And these are the smaller ones. That's not even the 16-inch ones. And so this is as far as I go, at least forward. I can still go aft and port and starboard and all those other nautical terms. What's this behind me? Armament, massive armament. It's especially beautiful when it's not being used, because after all, when it is in use, it's killing people.
got two failing systems put on board, explosive weapon system, 3,000 rounds a minute, at 2,000.
That's an excellent piece of hardware right there.
5-inch guns. You said 14 people would be crammed into this thing?
Yep.
There's actually a diagram here when you're done looking around inside. You have a diagram that shows how they'd be crammed inside. Right over here.
Oh my God. Look at that.
Now the key to that, the secret is when you're standing here, you're not moving.
Yeah, I see
you
that.
You got a mark, and you're standing on your mark.
For
as long as it takes.
Yeah, until they release you from battle stations.
Yeah. Yeah.
My dad shot the turret number two, the 16-inch guns.
Oh, here?
I'm in New Jersey.
I'm in Jersey.
Yeah, the sister ship in Vietnam.
Oh, wow.
So he's gonna love these videos and all these pictures I'm taking.
Yeah.
Go on YouTube. There's one called Turret for All.
Sweeper.
We make it go bang real good.
Sweep down all lower decks, ladder wells, and passageways. Hold all trash and garbage on station. Down sweepers.
We do it for like the Christmas boat parade.
Very steep ladders. Interesting. Honestly, I'm surprised that the state of California is letting these areas be open where the ladders are so steep. People are so hypersensitive to being sued. You'd think it would be closed for safety reasons, but it's not. So I definitely appreciate that. To go crawling around in here, but I can't. Ooh. Must be the radar room or something. Even higher. We are on the bridge of a super dreadnought battleship. This is so badass.
San Pedro traffic, San Pedro traffic, Forest Arena, Berlin, sir, how do you read over?
Forest Arena, in this track, in Black America.
Yes, sir, Forest Arena, Berlin, now at the exit, departure begins on the other.
Forest Arena, traffic, running up, check you out, this is some kind of state boys.
Thank you very much, I'll be sending my channel on 6, thank you.
Traffic, Catalina Duke. Welcome to the most scenic view of the harbor. This was one of the fire control stations, and this was also where you can see
17 inches of armor.
Yeah, and then this bulletproof glass is about like yay thick or something.
Okay, cool. Are these antennas in the front here, these two big poles?
These two big poles are communications towers. Those were installed in the 1980s. I'm pretty sure these two were to communicate with satellites.
I gotcha.
And then also installed in the 80s was that big apparatus at the front. We nicknamed the Christmas tree.
Right, okay.
Especially around Christmas time because we put lights on there and it looks really pretty. And that was installed in the 1980s as well for codes. Encryption. I was talking down below about the three gauges right in front of the helmsman.
Mm-hmm.
Well, these are those three gauges.
Duplicates up here?
Mm-hmm. So you have a speed indicator. You have a rudder indicator. This is actually a little bit broken. But it would say what angle your rudder's at, and then you have an order wheel. And the idea was that when, let's say you were going at course 300 on the compass, and you wanna turn 10 degrees to the left to port, you'd say, you'd turn this wheel till it matches 310, and then ease rudder. And the ship would ease over. That tells the helmsman, ease over. If it's like a torpedo coming, you crank this over to hard over, which tells the helmsman basically throw the wheel to one side.
Okay. And everybody holds on tight.
Mm-hmm. And then we all go for a ride.
Awesome.
Okay, I'll leave one side open.
Yeah.
What's significant about this stuff now?
So this is the armament that was added in the 80s. So these are the Tomahawk cruise missile boxes. And you can see inside here.
Oh, neat.
Where it sat.
Ah. Cool.
So these boxes would arrive at the ship preloaded. They didn't carry reloads.
I gotcha.
What they had was what they got. Actually, you can see these bolts here, so they'd arrive at the ship already loaded.
Mm-hmm.
A crane would pick them up, set them on the ship, they'd be bolted down, we'd go on our way.
What is this thing right here?
Gypsy winch.
Gypsy winch.
For okay. UNRWS. Underway replenishments. And also to help lower some of the boats in the water, from what I understand, so I can tell you. Dual purpose.
So, believe it or not, everything you see here was actually added in the 80s. In the 80s, you had these boxes stacked pretty high.
So it was worse.
Yep. Before in the 80s, you had a locker you could put your things in. You had a strap you could put up and keep you from rolling out in bad weather. You had a little curtain you can close for some privacy. In the 1940s, they had none of that.
Wow.
So this picture here, I love to point out, is what was here in the 1940s. Yeah.
I see the difference.
All all the doors from the main deck up are weather tight, which means if a big wave hits that door, the door's gonna hold. But all the doors from the main deck down are watertight, which means if the entire ocean is on the other side of that door, this door has to hold. And some of them were designed like this, because you've seen the ones up further where each one has its own little handle, but they also had these ones. These are called quick-acting doors, but they're all hooked up to one central wheel. In fact, the idea was that you turn the wheel. Here's an open with the dogs point in. So you shut the door, you turn the wheel back out. And voila. In fact, this is so easy, I can do it with one pinky. Give it a try.
You said the tables and chairs were added in the 80s?
Yeah, in the 40s it was two long picnic benches that ran the entire length of the room.
Wow, no kidding.
But the best part, the part that everyone likes, at least if you were in the 80s, was right here, the ice cream machine. So during the 1940s, battleships, aircraft carriers, and submarines, with an apology for the small space, had ice cream machines on board. Most navies in the 40s served a ration of alcohol, but the U.S. Navy, there was no alcohol allowed, so instead they served ice cream. Smaller ships had to do without. However, if sometimes you could happen to find an ice cream machine just lying about unused and put it to good use, by which I mean you'd steal one and install it on your ship, but most of them had to resort to more creative means. So destroyers quickly realized that, let me back up a bit. When aircraft carriers were operating, they were what were called plane guard destroyers. So you had the aircraft carrier up front, behind and on the side you have a destroyer. The idea was that if a plane was damaged, it couldn't land, it would ditch, the destroyer would zip over, pick up the crew. What they quickly realized is they could ransom the crew back to their carrier in exchange for ice cream. So it was normally about 10 gallons per person. And one air crewman was worth 10 gallons. But if you got a squadron commander, especially a popular one, let the bidding begin. The record for the most amount of ice cream paid for a single man was 25 gallons.
Oh my God, it must have been an important dude.
Yeah. For the next 3 days, that destroyer was very happy.
Hey, that looks like the shell my dad would have shot. That's a 16-inch projectile, right?
It's actually 8-inch.
8-inch. Wow, so twice as much as that would be the ones that my dad did.
Yeah. The accident in 1989 is kind of the elephant in the room when it comes to this ship. And so we wanted to put together an exhibit that didn't just talk about the accident aboard our ship, but similar accidents aboard other ships.
I gotcha. I'll have to come back and this is a room I'd spend a lot of time exploring and reading, but I'm more concerned about doing that video. Yeah. The front, so I just have to come back another time and look at more of this stuff.
You just have to come see us again.
Wow.
Yeah, it was a terrible accident and it turned into a huge mess, but the thing that we really emphasize is that it was a day. It was another day. It was a day of gunnery practice.
Mm-hmm.
No one ever expected this would happen. No one ever thought that this would happen. And no one ever thought that this day would be the last day in the lives of 47 people.
Yeah, no kidding. I got pictures of the memorial on turret number 2 earlier in the tour.
Yeah.
I remember turret 2.
Mm-hmm. And these are pictures the ship's photographer in 1989 donated to us.
Cool.
And he donated them to us on the condition that we play them in exactly the order that he gave
that
them
he gave
to us.
To. Okay.
And the reason why for that is he knew that a lot of museums, if they just dump pictures, would basically put together a photo montage of the accident, and that's not what he wanted. There's like 30 pictures in this montage, and only 3 or 4 are from the accident. That's just emphasizing again that this was a day.
Right. I'll just have to come back and spend more time in this section of the ship because I could spend a lot of time here.
Yeah. This was actually, your dad would probably see this. This is the hatch cover for turret 2.
And when the explosion happened, I mean, they could tell something was wrong because smoke started billowing out. But actually, this hatch cover was shut, and it blew it off its hinges and sent it skidding along the deck. It actually almost went over the side of the O1 level. And so we have here, this is the hatch cover that was recovered. And you can see how concave it is. A look that I personally like a lot better, but I'm a history buff. I'm a bit of a purist. I like the World War II look better. This is in Iowa. This is her sister, Missouri.
Right, one of the four, one of the great four.
Mm-hmm. And actually, Iowa didn't have this 40mm mount atop turret 2. It had 320s.
And its original design.
Its original design, because this was built to command a fleet. And so the 40mm mount actually blocked the view from the Admiral's Bridge.
Mm-hmm.
And so they put 20s in there instead.
I'll have to come back on another trip when I have more time and do more looking around here too. It's turret number 3, back of the ship, aft, as they say in nautical terms.
Gotta stay up with you.
Sure,
sure. I gotta put all these lines back up afterward.
So we just went behind the scenes here.
Yep.
Not normally part of the self-guided tour, but I'm the son of a senior chief, so why not?
During the 40s, this was all anti-aircraft guns.
Tons more guns than that original model.
And actually, there's another 5-inch mount right up here. You see that little circle?
Yep. That's where it was. Cool.
We have a few pigeons.
Yeah, I saw that. The pigeons. Pigeons like the battle wagons.
Yeah. I don't know. This might look a little bit familiar.
Oh yeah. The moon looks really cool up there.
Yeah, it really does. Well, this is nice. We've had a lot of cold weather recently, so it's good to be back to California sun for a change.
Good. I'm from Wisconsin. Tell me about it.
Yeah, it's like I moved here from Virginia last year. I thought I was escaping this, man.
So they never brought Turret 2 back to functionality, right? I'd imagine there would be
not
no need
really.
To. Yeah, I didn't think so.
They just... And it's never going to be open to the public.
No. Ship is now closed. We're taking this last one. Yep.
You see that yellow on the yellow arrow on the turret?
Yep.
That arrow is pointing at a very tiny little dent. That's all it did.
From a 6-inch gun.
From a 6-inch gun. We got a little bit too close to a Japanese artillery battery.
In World War II.
In World War II. We learned from your dad, military intelligence, a bit of an oxymoron. They said the Japanese only had 4-inch guns, they actually had 6-inch guns.
And it still did no damage.
And so we got close enough for the 5 inches to open up, and one of them took a couple pot shots at us. There's actually a little thing here that shows what it looked like right after it happened. So it scorched some of the paint and bent some of the sheet metal. The captain sent some sailors out with paintbrushes and a welding torch. It was good as new in a few hours.
Nice. All right, thanks. Appreciate it.
Our pleasure.
Stop that woman.
So I just toured this battleship behind me, and tomorrow I'm going to be on a ship of a different sort, a cruise ship. It'll be a bit more luxurious. So I was just making the mental note to myself, and now on this camera, of the contrast between today and then tomorrow, the next day, of the type of ship and its decorum in every other way possible, how vastly different it is in its purpose and its mission, and, well, its decorum. So, catching my cruise tomorrow, the contrast I will enjoy. Take care. Okay, this is a big deal to me. My dad served in the Vietnam War on the USS New Jersey. Super dreadnought battleship, the most powerful gunship ever built in the world. There's four of these battleships. One of them is the Iowa, so that'd be my dad's sister ship. I'm about to see her, or any of these battleships, for the first time in my life. I just flew into Las Vegas last night, drove across the desert today. Now I'm in San Pedro, LA County, California, and I'm just about to turn the corner where I believe I'm gonna have my first sight ever on this battleship. So, I'm gonna turn the camera around so that you guys can see what I see. Okay, so I think after past this little building here, it will open up, the sky will open up, and I will be able to see it with all of you. Just as a side note, I don't know how well you can see all these shiners, but coming down here driving, I mean, millions of these shipping containers that carry so much product from overseas, and we wonder why we have no jobs here in America. That's a little side note. It blows my mind. But anyway, turning this corner, and I think I'll be able to see it for the first time ever. This is a big deal to me. I've never seen my dad's battleship before. And when I get back home, I will show my dad this video. Why wouldn't I? And was I right? There it is. Oh, that is so cool. I gotta wait for this crosswalk now. Hurry up, crosswalk, let me over. Just making for a live feed video. So while we are waiting, all those millions of shipping containers from overseas decimating our jobs. Oh my god, we're seeing it firsthand. And we wonder why there's no good jobs in this country. It's right there. All those containers coming from other countries. It's a long stoplight, man. Sure makes for a boring live feed. I don't know. Hi, Kara. Hi, Maureen. Stupid light. Well, if I save this, this part will be edited out. But since this is live, nothing I can do about it. Hi, Karen. Thanks for sharing my video. Waiting for this light to change so I can cross. And by the way, I'm gonna be doing some videos when I'm on the ship too. I'm gonna be taking all kinds of pictures inside and out, and it's gonna be awesome. Okay, good. The crosswalk finally freaking changed. Alright, good. Crossing the railroad tracks. Okay, so I have no idea where to go. Okay, so drones are illegal here, that's cool. Wow, there it is. Oh, this is so cool. I guess I'll pretend I was driving here. I've done this little driveway. And there's the entrance.
Turn right.
BB-61, Battleship 61 for the USS Iowa. You see, let's see here. Two gun turrets at the front of the gun turret number two in the Vietnam War. It's kind of hard for me to tell if this thing is even focused on it or not, but I see one gun turret, then you see the back one, the guns are pointed up at a 45 degree angle. Those are the ones my dad fired in the Vietnam War. So, Then there's another gun turret in the back. Wow, this is such a badass ship. I like it better when it's not, you know, killing people. So these bullets, they're about 6 feet tall, and those turrets, they're 16 inches in diameter, about 6 feet tall, and they can go for a range of, I want to say my dad told me like 45 miles or something like that. And on average, when it hits land, it leaves a crater something like 10 feet deep by, what did he say, 20, 30, 40 feet wide or something like that. And one time with those guns, they put an island underwater. They shot at this island off the coast of Vietnam so much that the whole island was literally submerged underwater by the time they were done. Well, there was a reason for it. They were shooting at them, so they shot back. Perhaps a little overkill, but anyway, that's what happened. Yes, this is in California. Hi, Bonnie. This is the port of San Pedro, LA County, California. Hey, Laura. Hopefully I'm going the right way here. And I see the plank over there, and there's a little building area in front of it, which is probably where I'm going to buy my ticket. I looked online beforehand. It's like $17.95. We'll say 18 bucks for an adult, which is me. I don't think I'll pass for a child under 12 or under 6 or a senior over whatever, and I'm not a veteran, so I will have to pay the full price, which I'm happy to do. And the little side guns you see there, those are little 5-inch guns. Pretty impressive ship, man. If you ever saw the movie Under Siege with Steven Seagal, what was it, the first one or the second one? I don't remember, but the one that took place on a battleship, that was the USS Missouri. Same exact battleship class. There's four of them. There's the Wisconsin.
Head south.
There's the Wisconsin. There's the, I can go this way, Missouri. There's the Iowa and the New Jersey. My dad is on the New Jersey. And this one is the Iowa. And they're all in the Iowa, the Iowa class. We could give a little history lesson. And something significant about the Missouri, by the way, the Japanese surrendered on deck of the USS Missouri, Iowa class battleship. Super dreadnought, the most powerful gunships ever made in the world, and there's four of them. Hey, Joanne. I'm gonna turn this off just before I buy my ticket, but I will be making more videos when I get on. I don't know if I'm gonna be doing more live feeds. I'm on the deck of it, but I'll do more like recorded videos and take pictures, and at the end of this trip, I'll put together some nice little video montage of all this stuff, inside and outside of the ship, you know, wherever they let me tool around. It'll be great. And the reason why they don't use these anymore, they've retired them. The last time one of these was in service was the first Gulf War, you know, the one that went well. And that was in like 1991, I think.
Head south.
And that was Missouri, I think. Was both of them. And then they retired them.
Turn right.
And the reason is because they're extremely expensive to use them. And there's just no these anymore. There's nobody in the world that has a superpower military or navy, so these particular ships are just not needed. It was just a sense that was kind of useless at that point. They were just too good for the times. They're too powerful to use them anymore. Kind of the badass reason to retire them. But it's cool, they actually kept all four of them. They're all floating museums in different parts of the country, like the Missouri. New Jersey's in Condon, New Jersey, or something like that. I think the Missouri is in Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. Obviously, the Iowa is in San Pedro, California. And the Wisconsin, I was just reading about where the Wisconsin is. I don't remember, but the Wisconsin, all four of them are somewhere. They didn't scrap any of them because they've all got so much historical significance. Like other military ships that they retire, they turn them into razor blades. That's what they say anyway, but they're just recycled into different scrap metal for different things. So look at that, you're learning at the same time. I've learned most of this stuff from my dad. Since the Vietnam War, however, these have been modernized a lot up until their retirement. Like those are fixed metal systems. So not just the guns that can go, I don't know, 35, 40 miles, but cruise missiles that can go hundreds of miles away. So now it's modernized into more of a long-range attacking ship. Thanks for the hearts, everybody. This is so cool. I just wanted to go step aboard this thing and pretend to know what it's like to be in my dad's shoes when he was on the thing during a time of war. Well, that will be impossible, but you know, I'll have fun with it. It'll be great. It's in honor of my dad, and we'll say everybody else too that has ever put their life on the lines for their country too, for that matter. God, this is so cool. Turret number two, that's my dad's. He was in charge of it. Right above turret number one. Well, thanks everyone for your love and support. I'm gonna turn this live feed off now and get on this thing, purchase my ticket, and then get on, and I'll probably do one more live feed somewhere on the deck, somewhere in front of my dad's turret would be cool. So thanks, mwah, bye.
Yeah, it goes real deep.
And then there's a valley.
Yeah, there's some water.